Hey, what's happening? Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Let There Be Talk. Today is December 28th. Hope everybody's doing great. This episode is brought to you by my monster kick-ass sponsor, Earthquaker Devices. You play guitar, bass, maybe some fucking keyboards, maybe sing, whatever. You want to run some pedals? You got to go to Earthquaker Devices, handmade in Akron, Ohio. You need some delay, reverb, boost, preamp, fuzz, overdrive, modulation, compression, octaves? You need it! Check them out. Earthquaker Devices has been my sponsor for 2 years now. Fantastic people. Handmade boutique guitar effects pedals. Perfect. Perfect. Rock and roll machines. Hit them up, earthquakerdevices.com. If you're going to be at the NAMM show, stop by their booth. I'll be there hanging out. Also, follow them on Twitter. Follow them on Twitter. God damn it, I can't talk today. Twitter and Instagram. Love you guys. Let's get into the episode today. What a great, great guest. Dave Kushner is here today from Velvet Revolver. So cool to have him on. Of course, everybody knows, if you listen to the show, that I auditioned for Velvet Revolver years ago. So I grilled him a little bit. Like, what happened? Why not me? All good, though. I'm not one of those people that always thinks, like, what if? Fuck you, what if? If anybody ever says what if to you, just fucking unfollow them in life. What if, man? Fuck it. What if? Just move on. I'm out of my mind today. I'm glad I didn't get that Velvet Revolver gig. I wouldn't have been a comedian. I'm insane. Insane in the membrane. Feeling good today. Dave's on. Not only did Dave play in Velvet Revolver, if you were like me, you were like, who is this guy when he was in Velvet Revolver? We find out today, this guy's been around forever. 100% lifer, rock and roll king. Went to school with Slash and my buddy Rami Jaffe. Grew up in Hollywood. Worked at Tower Records back then. You know, Axl used to... Tower Video, actually, across the street from Tower Records on Sunset, where Axl managed and Slash worked and all kinds of rockers worked there. If you had long hair, Tower would hire you. Need more Tower Records in our life. But I find out all kinds of great stuff about Dave. One of the great things he's doing right now is he's working on Bill Burr's show, F is for Family, doing all the music for that. And if you haven't seen F is for Family, what the fuck are you doing? Get on Netflix right away and watch all 6 episodes of this insane cartoon. Laugh your head off. You might need some laughs. Get on there today. Dave's doing all the music for that. He also wrote the song for Sons of Anarchy, which I never even knew. The Crow Fly Straight. You know that hit? Yeah. So this guy fucking works, man. Awesome. Awesome guest. Get to the episode here in a minute. Before I do, I'm in San Francisco today, and I hope to see all of you if you live in the Bay Area. Don't be lazy. Come see me tonight and tomorrow night at the Punchline. 8 o'clock tonight, 8 o'clock tomorrow. Do not miss it. Kevin Christie's here with me. We're going to be bringing the candles, lighting the candles. Come out tonight. Tell your friends, whatever. San Francisco tonight, Punchline. San Francisco tomorrow, and then San Jose, New Year's Eve. with Eric Griffin from the Workaholics. Going to be at the San Jose Improv with Eric Griffin New Year's Eve. And then all the way through to the Sunday. Everybody that came to Fresno, thank you. What a great, great night, man. So fucking fun. The Tower Theater. When I was young, I think I saw the Hindenburg there. So long ago. But Tower Theater Fresno, it was rocking. Crowd was amazing. Everybody in Fresno came out full comedy force. Sam Tripoli, thanks for having Ian and I on that show. Ian Edwards, Sam Tripoli, and myself had a great time. Steve Henry came out, my good friend. We all carpooled in his Prius and spent $4 on gas. As Ian would say, you could give an owner with a Prius 80s gas money. Like, hey, let me chip in for gas. You give them 80s style gas money, $5, and they're not insulted. I love it. Great, great weekend. Also, we're just sitting here patiently waiting for the GNR Coachella announcement. I mean, I don't know if it's happening, but what I'm saying is it just smells like it's about to explode. Apparently, they threw a little weird trailer before Star Wars in the theaters, just with playing Welcome to the Jungle with like a black and white audience. I mean, this shit is genius how they're doing it. They just upped their website with the original logo. Shit's about to happen. Shit is about to happen. I was acting like I was like, yeah, all right, cool. But I'm actually pretty fired up. I'm not going to lie. I'm fired up. I love all you guys. I hope you have a safe New Year's Eve. Get out there and kick some ass. If you want to donate to the podcast, everybody's been asking. I've set up a Patreon page. Patreon is fantastic. Super easy to donate. Just go to patreon.com/DeanDelRay. And Patreon is spelled patreon.com. Patreon.com/DeanDelRay. And donate. Helps out with the podcast. Helps with expenses. This shit ain't cheap, dog. I love all you guys. Keep those reviews going on iTunes and subscribe. If you do that, a lot of people don't know, but that helps get the show into the top 50. I'm at 450 reviews, trying to reach 500 by the end of the year. I hope I can do it. I mean, I got thousands of listeners. If just 50 of you leave a review and subscribe, we'll be blowing up. We'll be at 500 by the end of the year. Del Razors. Fucking put down the pipe and take 1 minute. Just press love the show. Boom. Leave a review. All right. Getting ready for the show tonight. San Fran. I'm in my hometown. Ready to rock. Going to do some podcasting while I'm here. I won't tell you who the guests will be, but there's going to be some good ones coming up here. Some Bay Area people while I'm here. And then hopefully Eric Griffin and I do a end of the year podcast together at the San Jose Improv. I love all you guys. Thanks, Dave, for doing the show. Watch F is for Family, people. And light the candles. All right, here we are. Another episode of Let Me Talk. Got a great guest today. Introduce yourself.
My name's Dave Kushner from Hollywood, California. Well, no. From... Sherman Oaks.
Yeah, S.O. Yeah,
Velvet Revolver.
Velvet Revolver.
Ah, dude. All right, yeah. Velvet Revolver.
You know, it's funny because I was just playing you the songs when I auditioned.
Yes.
And you were naming the tunes. And it was so long ago, right?
It was 13 years ago.
13 years ago. You know, you're right, because I've lived here 13 years, and I remember I was only here for about 6 months, and my buddy McBob was working for Duff, and he's like, hey, man, they're putting together a band. Don't tell anybody.
Except he talks like this. They're putting together a band. Just give me a tape, and I'll give it to Duff.
And he had just teched for a tour I did opening for Wallflowers. So he was giving me the insight, like, you got to get on this, man. Yeah. And I remember I was thinking, like, holy shit, if I got this, I only moved to L.A. for 6 months, and I'm singing, like, in the new GNR.
Yes.
You know, your mind starts spinning and shit. Dude. And But when I first was going, I think Izzy was still, he was kind of in and out, right? Was he there?
Well, it's funny because you say that thing about like, oh, my mind started spinning. And like my experience was, I had an experience during the band, which was the opposite where, you know, I was in the band and we were looking for, so it was, you know, originally it was Josh, Todd, and Keith from Buck
Cherry.
Oh, that's
right. I forgot about that.
For a couple months, it was that.
And what was that like?
It was all right, man. I heard like, I think I have it somewhere, dude. I have like an 8-song demo.
Yeah.
And, but for some reason, it just didn't work out. And so they parted ways with Josh. And then Keith stayed in the band for like a week or two. And then he got fired or whatever.
Yeah.
Parted ways with,
he got
fired. And then I was already playing in a band with Duff. So Duff had.
Were we playing Loaded?
Yeah, I was playing Loaded. And, but he and I were doing this other project too, but he said, dude, learn these songs. He gave me that 8-song demo and he's like, learn these songs. I'm gonna have you come in like after, in like next week. And then the next day he said, dude, I fired Keith. You gotta come in tomorrow. I was like, oh shit. And
now there was no Izzy ever?
No, so I was in the band.
Okay.
And I was in, and then after like 4 months of being in that band, and we would rehearse like 5 days a week.
Yeah.
For, you know. And then Izzy started coming around. I'm like, fuck, great. Oh, great.
yeah.
Know, like, what am I going to do now? And and then my head started going like, oh, what are we going to have? 3 guitar players? No, I'm out. You know, and Duff was like, dude, he'll just come around for 2 weeks and then he'll split.
Yeah.
He can't stay anywhere for more than a couple weeks.
Wow.
And it was totally true. And then he just came, he hung out, he wrote some songs. We all played together, all five of us. And then he was gone in 2 weeks.
Now, when Izzy was there, first of all, Izzy's like a fucking ghost besides Axel. Like, so when he comes in, what kind of guy is he? Like, is he quiet or, cause he's a great songwriter, you know?
He's actually is like a ghost, like an apparition. You can actually kind of see through him. he's fine. He's so cool, dude. Like he's really so cool and nice and like just loves life and all kinds of weird shit. Like not weird, but like, for instance, when he first came around, he's like, yeah, I was just in Mexico for like, or in Baja, somewhere like racing pickup trucks. There's this like whole scene where they...
Oh, he's doing like, was he doing the Baja 1000 kind of stuff?
Yeah, like he's like, oh, there's this whole scene where they like, you know, trick out like pickup trucks and they do these races in the desert and blah, blah, blah. And then like... Another time he came back and he was talking about some other like weird go-kart.
Oh yeah.
Racing.
I always heard the like the myth of him, or it's probably true, but he moved back to Indiana.
Yeah.
And then he bought like a ranch or something and he built a go-kart track in the back. I think McBob told me that one. And I was like, what a fucking, you know.
He's a trip, man. He's just always like doing new shit. Like when Velvet Revolver was going, we were on tour in Europe and he was like, all of a sudden, you know, it's like we play all these festivals and they're like out in the middle of nowhere. So every time we got on, you know, we'd go to the gig, we'd go on the bus.
Yeah.
So we'd go in the hotel, then we'd go down to the bus and we'd all drive out to the gig. And then all of a sudden we get on the bus and Izzy's on the bus and Duff's like, yeah, dude, I guess he was fucking just cruising around and he showed
backpacking
up.
Backpacking through Europe.
Dude, and no, I'll start talking to him. I'm like, oh, dude, what are you doing here? He's like, oh, I was just riding my bike through Italy.
Wow.
And I was like, what do you mean? Like, he's like, yeah, it's like, we drive by the front of the hotel and there's like a bicycle chained up to a pole.
No.
He's like, yeah, there's my bike right there.
No way, man.
Then he went with us for 3 days from Italy to like wherever we went, Spain, and then some other country, like 3 days in a row. Just stayed with us and then went back and was like, oh, dude, I hope the bike's still there. And
that's some just rich, eccentric rock star stuff.
He's just, you know, trippy.
I mean, he wrote some of the greatest songs in GNR, but he's definitely trippy because, you know, other than Axel, you never hear about this guy. There's no books. There's no photos. He's completely like a Howard Hughes of rock. Just where is this guy?
He's off the grid, dude.
Yeah, he really is, man. Yeah. Okay, so he disappears and they say you're in?
Yeah, I was already in But he just came around and they're like, well, we're gonna, Izzy's here, let's write some songs,
right?
Because at that point we would rehearse 5 days a week.
I remember that.
And we would just write songs every day. And then we would also like be together to get, you know, cassettes and stuff like what you sent in, you know, because that was like 2003. So it was right before
CDs,
MP3s.
Oh, and, yeah. You couldn't email shit.
Yeah. You couldn't email shit.
Yeah. So, actually, yeah. That's what I did. They gave me a CD. Yeah. I dumped it in Pro Tools, wrote the stuff, then brought the CD back. That's what I did. Yeah.
So we had like, and then at one point we kind of said, I think it was on KLOS that they said, you know, okay, if you're, there's a new band, you know, if you were interested in singing for it. Yeah. So we would get, so McBob would go to this PO box and pick up these fucking boxes full of CDs and cassettes and
videos,
VHS tapes.
Yeah.
And we would literally sit there in a, like a conveyor belt, all on the couch. McBob would open up the package. Like I would, you know, take out the CD and hand it to Duff, and then I would, you know, read the bio, and it's like it would just go down the line. And right. Slash would be next to the big like CD player we had in the studio, and then we would just listen for like sometimes like 10 seconds.
Yeah,
it's just like, all right, next, and then it's
just, I remember they filmed some of that on VH1,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
because I remember that process. It just like I mean, you know, it's funny because I talked to somebody a couple of days ago on the show, and there's singers out there.
Yeah.
But I think that people, I don't know, it takes a lot of work. Like, are we going to bring this guy? Like, you guys flew some dudes in, right?
Yeah, we flew in one guy from the UK.
I remember seeing him, yeah.
He's in the special.
Yeah, he's on the special, yeah.
Steven. He was rad, like his old band was really cool because it was kind of a little more modern, kind of reminded us like Faith No More.
Yeah.
Which was cool. And, but he just, it's weird, man. Cause it's like, you can be good, like in your band, and then you could sing on our stuff and then that could be good too. But then you could get in the room and then just like that guy. He just like, I don't know if he couldn't handle the pressure, or it's just like, it wasn't.
Yeah.
Or when you hear it not produced, you know, not with a doubled vocal and you're
singing. The guy, he's singing flat or he just, or maybe he can only sing for 20, 30 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, guys, they're not used to like rehearsing every day and their band plays once a month. It's funny, when I heard the stuff, I was like, oh, this is so in my wheelhouse. And then I also looked at it as like, I'm going to kind of approach it a little more. It was after, you know, of course, like GNR. It had some flavors of that, but I also approached it in more of kind of an Audio Slave Cornell vibe,
right?
With some kind of jellyfish kind of like choruses, you know, that were kind of like stacked choruses.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I could imagine what comes through, because just when you're not famous and you're looking for a guitar player or something, it's just like, oh, it's never going to happen.
It was fucking horrible.
Like a guy will have the look and he'll be horrible.
Yeah.
Then a guy won't have the look and he'll be killer, but he'll be just like 300 pounds. And we're talking rock, you know?
Yeah.
But I remember that time because I was out every night in Hollywood. When I first moved here, I'd be out every night. And I kept seeing Sorm at clubs, you know, looking at singers and stuff. Yeah. And the one that I really thought was going to get it was Shooter Jennings, because he had Stargun at the time,
right,
which was an incredible fucking band. And they were killing it at the Viper Room. They would play like once a month and all these beautiful girls would show up and they were playing rock. And
they were kind of like GNR.
They were straight GNR, except for they had a left-handed guitar player.
The Frog, dude.
Frog. Which is against the rules of rock for me.
That guy's badass, though.
He is, though. Oh,
he's
fucking amazing. That band was great.
Yeah.
You know?
They were a good band.
I remember they had a party in Venice at some hipster guy's house, and they played, and there was hundreds of hot girls, like rich Malibu girls, you know? And they had it going on big time. And then
was at that party, dude.
You were?
Yeah, I think me and Duff were at that party because we had talked to...
I think that's why they played. So you guys could come see him sing.
Because I'd known Shooter. We had a mutual friend, Sean Resigliano, who used to manage Stargun.
Yeah.
So my friend Sean brought Shooter to my old house, and like the week he moved here from Nashville, I think.
Yeah.
And So I'd known him since then. And I really liked Stargun.
Yeah,
and
me too. They had some great tunes, right?
Yeah, and then
like that Sunset Strip one.
Yeah, but Duff and I were working together at the it was right before VR, or maybe right when it started, but I remember we, you know, wanted to, me and Duff were talking about producing some Stargun stuff together.
Yeah.
And then I don't remember what happened.
I got the demo. I sometimes play it on the podcast because it's really,
I got the shirt.
It's really fucking good.
Yeah.
You know, they had that Mustangs and Camaros. Yeah. Remember that song? It was so great. But they had an incredible ballad. And that's what takes your band to the next level. Like, you guys on the first record had a great ballad. GNR had Sweet Child of Mine, which is a fucking monster. They had a great ballad, man, that was really good.
Yeah.
And it was a bummer that he abandoned that. And because I remember his record came out, and I bought it at Tower on Sunset.
Yeah.
I went in, I got in my car, and it was country. I walked right back and went, hey, I got the wrong record. And back then, you couldn't really return. Yeah, yeah. And they go, sorry, man. I go, no, this is a country record. You should have had it in the country section. And then they gave me my money back. And then later, I liked it.
Like, are you talking about The Wolf?
The Shooter's first record. Yeah, and then the second one, too, both of them.
He had a record called The Wolf that's killer.
Yeah.
I fucking love that record.
Yeah, right. It's like, at first, it was just such a shocker that it was like, oh, country. Yeah.
His and now it's funny because his kids go to school with my kids.
Is that right?
Yeah, and I see him all the time.
Yeah, oh, he's still in L.A., huh?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I thought he moved to Nashville because he was with the Sopranos girl for a long time. They had a kid or whatever.
Yeah, there are two kids.
Oh, wow.
Go to school with my kids.
Yeah, that guy's that was a great band.
Yeah,
that was a good band. So
he's a talented motherfucker, that guy.
Yeah. Right. To me, when I looked at Velvet Revolver, of course, I don't know anything about you. So immediately I go, this guy won the jackpot. Who is he?
Yeah.
So who were you before? Okay, you played in Loaded. And recently I found out you were in Danzig for a minute.
Mm.
Right? Yeah. So are you from L.A.?
I'm third generation L.A. guy.
Wow.
My grandfather went to Hamilton High. My dad went to L.A. High. My parents met at LACC. So, and I grew up down on Vermont, like first in Vermont.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I went to...
In like the Hillcrest area? I mean the...
yeah, Hillcrest.
Like Larchmont and Hillcrest.
Yeah, I was born at like Kaiser on Sunset in Vermont. Born and raised here. I went to Fairfax High and you know, I grew up with...
Fairfax, did you hang with like Rami Jaffe and those guys?
I went to school... Rami was a grade younger than me.
Wow.
And then Slash was a grade older.
Right.
And then like Tracy Guns.
Yep.
Was in the same grade as Slash.
Did you hang with those guys? Or
yeah, no? I hung out with all those guys.
Oh, wow. Yeah, so you've been around since like Ground Zero.
Yeah. Yeah, it was great, man. I mean, well, Slash and I think Rami went to Bancroft too. We all went to junior high too together. And
wow.
So after that, I just like, I went through high school. I played in punk bands like, you know, in like 9th, 10th grade, I think I was trying to sing in punk bands.
Yeah.
You know,
who were you into? Like Circle Jerks, stuff like that.
Yeah, Circle Jerks, X, Black Flag.
Oh yeah. Amazing. Right.
All those bands, you know, which was cool. Cause they were still playing at the Starwood.
Yeah.
So I'd go to the Starwood and see those bands.
Devo.
I got, that's how you get into it. You know, it's like you get into
Devo is the kiss of punk.
Yeah, it's B-52s and
yeah, Rock Lobster
first.
Yeah,
and then it's like, then it's like you start to dip your toe in the Circle Jerks water.
Yeah,
you know, and then so I went full on into like all that stuff, and then I ended up playing in Wasted Youth.
Oh wow,
that was like the first band I was in that actually had like a record deal, kind of, and that's where I met Joey, who played in
Joey C.
Queens of the Stone Age. So he and I were in that band together, and then. From there, I was in this band called the Electric Love Hogs with...
Oh, I remember. Yeah. Hey, who was the singer in that band?
John Feldman.
Yeah.
Who's now this big producer.
Dude, Electric Love Hogs, man. I fucking forgot about that band.
Yeah, and the drummer from Orgy.
Yeah.
And so I went from that, and then we had a record deal, and then Tommy Lee produced part of our record.
What label were you on, Geffen?
Polygram.
Polygram.
And then that was the way... it's just like all these weird like little stepping stones, because... The guy who produced our record was the guy who produced Lights, Camera, Revolution, the Suicidal record. And he was doing the Infectious Grooves record at the same time, at the same studio, because there was two different rooms. So he was doing our record and Infectious. The guitar player from Infectious, I had gone to school with too, Adam.
Yeah.
And so then I ended up playing on the Infectious record, like literally just walking across the hall, playing, you know, a couple solos on the Infectious record, then going back. Then Robert and Mike from Suicidal came and sang some backups on one of our things. And that's how I became friends with Robert. And, you know, it's just like, then I played in this band Sugar Tooth, and then I played in.
Oh, yeah, man. Now, were you at, like, because that's Joey C.
Yeah.
And I fucking love Sold My Fortune. And it was funny because when I was doing some research on Joey C, usually I don't even look, see what the people have done, because I like it to come out organically. Yeah, yeah. But at this particular time, I only knew Joey C from Queens.
Yeah.
So I didn't want to just spend a whole hour on Queens. So I look up and he was originally in Sugar Tooth, and I fucking love that record.
Yeah.
So I actually talked to him like a half hour on Sugar Tooth because I love that song, Sold My Fortune, and the record. Killer. I still have it, man. Were you in it from the beginning?
No.
Okay.
But... So here's how this happened.
Yeah.
The thing you gotta know about me is I literally have a story about everything.
Yeah.
So I was working at Tower Video.
Yeah.
On Sunset.
Axel's old job.
Yeah. Axel and Slash both worked
there. That's some more weird shit, right?
Yeah. You know? And so I was in the Love Hogs, and I was working at Tower with this dude, Burko, who's now like an A&R guy. Burko was a singer in a band called She Died.
Right.
And so Burko said, dude, I need a drummer. And since I had just quit Wasted Youth, and Wasted Youth was kind of not happening anymore, I said, you got to get this guy, Joey. Yeah. He's fucking like my favorite drummer. Dude, you got to get this guy. Joey ended up playing and She Died. She Died, fired Burko, and then became Sugar Tooth.
Wow.
So that's how Joey got.
Yeah, then they get this guy from fucking The Valley, he tells me.
Yeah, and then they got Mark.
Yeah.
And then, so that band went, at the same time the Love Hogs was going, and then they had this other guitar player, this guy, Tim, who they ended up firing. And that's when Joey, you know, asked me, cause I'd just gotten out of Love Hogs. And
so
I ended up playing, I did like a couple tours with them, and then that was it. But you know, the bass player, you ever go to Pace?
No.
Restaurant on Laurel Canyon?
No. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. With the Italian joint at the top.
Dude,
yeah.
Josh Blum, the bass player, manages that place. Oh,
that's hilarious, yeah, man. I love that restaurant. I never know the name of it. I just call it Under the Country Mark.
Yeah, it's good.
Wow. So you've actually been around forever. Because, you know, when you're on the outside and you don't know, you go like, who's that guy? How did he fucking score this gig?
Yeah.
So let's get back to the singer search. Of course, I know what happened. You got offered to do a song for the Hulk.
Yeah.
And then somehow Scott comes in and you guys do a song for the Hulk, right?
Yeah, kind of. We kind of manufactured it a little bit more. You know, we had been talking to Scott. We had talked to Scott kind of in the middle of that 10-month period when we were looking
at
the
singers. Any other big guys?
Not as big as Scott.
Right.
But, you know, we went out to other people. Like, we went out to Mike Patton from Faith No More.
Oh, yeah.
And
that would have been weird, right?
Yeah, but he's so great, man.
Oh, he's my favorite. Are you kidding me? Angel Dust is one of the top records ever to come out of the Bay Area besides, say, Metallica, Master of Puppets.
Yeah.
Angel Dust. And recently, I've been re-listening to the first Patton record, not the one with Chuck Mosley, but the first one with Epic. Yeah. And holy fuck.
Yeah.
And I saw those guys hundreds of times, loved them. They played the Stone, and Jim Martin was a god to me.
Yeah.
And what an amazing guy Mike Patton is.
Yeah.
But I don't know if it would have worked with you guys.
Right.
Because it's like he's such a outside the box guy.
Yeah.
And you guys, at the end of the day, you do need some radio songs.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, you know, we reached out to some other guys like that, but Scott was the one that we were kind of stuck on. And at one point earlier on in that process, he had said no, because he was still kind of holding on to SCP.
Right.
And then they split from each other. And then we asked him again. And then he said yes. And then we basically did the same thing we did, you know, the same way you got a demo. It's like we gave him three songs and he picked one. And he just put vocals on one song, which was the song that ended up in
on the Hulk, Hulk one,
which was Set Me Free. And you know, we he came down and he was still kind of fucked up at the time, and he just said, you know.
Now was that like a red flag to you guys? Like to me, it seems like there's to you guys, you think there's no one out there. Yeah. This sounds great. We're going to have to put up with this stuff. Because we're talking about guys in your band that were on drugs for years, you know? Yeah. And they're all clean. Maybe, I don't know if they were at the time or whatever, but that's a weird element to bring in when you got a guy. I mean, once I stopped partying, I can't hang out with partiers anymore.
Right.
Because it's those same weird excuses of like, dude, my car's got a flat. Oh, dude, oh, my kid. You know, they start making up stories all the time. And you're like, hey, man. Yeah.
The junkies are the worst, dude.
They are the worst.
They got the worst stories.
I played with two of them, and they always got the worst stories, and they're always like, I always think like, dude, I'm 45. You think I don't want to go get high right now? Yeah. I just don't do it.
Yeah, we were definitely apprehensive, but the song was so great, and we had been looking for so long, and we were just like, you know, I think too, like at that point, we had two managers, and we... I think that we collectively believed that we could get past any obstacle because we could collectively figure out how to get past it.
And also, which happened. Also, you don't even know if it's going to take off. So why are you looking at 2-3 years down the road? Let's just look at today. This sounds good, right?
Yeah, but in all honesty, I think we knew. You know, we did know that there... We knew that there was like massive... As soon as... He sang on a song, and as soon as we kind of decided, like, okay, we'll get this guy.
Yeah.
Like, even the when we gave him the tape and we got the tape back and we heard it, and it was fucking, it was that song. It sounded no different.
Yeah.
It was that song that was in the Hulk, that was on the record, and we were like, all right, now what? We're like, we're stuck. We're like, we have to get this guy. It's
because
awesome.
You've put it out as the Hulk.
Well, no, before that, we just heard it. This is great, and then we just, you know. As soon as it was like, as soon as we knew we were going to get him, we knew. Like, our, you know, manager started feeling stuff out. And, like, that's how we got that, you know, with the Hulk. Because that was, like, our manager's idea. It was like, let's get a soundtrack first. Because there was all these, there was, like, Mission Impossible and all these big movies were coming out.
Yeah.
And that's how, you know, it was their idea to, like, let's break the band through a soundtrack. And then we'll do a record deal.
That's a good idea, too.
It's great.
Because if people don't really dig it, you can just say, oh, it was a one-off for a soundtrack, and you could have moved on.
Right.
You know?
Exactly.
And then people just started grabbing it because they were so starving for rock.
Yeah.
That's when it really blew me away that, like, Stargun didn't stick around because you're like, look, at that time.
Yeah.
What year is that?
That was 2003.
Because I think, like, a year later, maybe, the Strokes take off. And the yes, and all that next wave of rock really fucking hits. Because the Strokes, to me, felt like the new GNR. They were dangerous. They did drugs. They wore leather jackets. They played dirty rock, you know?
Yeah.
And not the same style, but they were bringing the rock thing back. By the time I saw them at, like, Troubadour Viper Room or something, I was like, whoa, this is rock.
Yeah.
You know, that New York gritty shit. You guys do that, and then you say, all right, you're in, and you're going to go do a record.
Yeah.
You already had the songs, right? He just had to write lyrics and sing.
Yeah, we had 60-some songs.
That's it. I remember going into Mates, and there was just a...
You saw the board?
Yeah, the board. Yeah. It just had songs, you know? And I was like, fuck, look at all the tunes, you know?
We had to get another board at one point. It was crazy.
Yeah, it is like, crazy.
Yeah, literally over 60 songs. And then we just gave them all to him.
Yeah.
And just said, dude, you know, make some songs. And then what was even crazier is okay, so we give him 60-some songs. And we're like, okay, just sort it out, dude. Just pick whatever you want. Do, you know. And within like a week or two, maybe a week, he gave us back Slither.
Yeah.
Fall to Pieces and Big Machine were the next three songs that we got.
Wow. And like, those were the singles.
Yeah. Exactly. The next three songs that we got back were the first three singles. And we were just like, you know.
Yeah. Falling to Pieces, great tune.
Yeah.
And Slither, killer video. I had the guy on that shot the video for.
Oh, Kevin?
Yeah.
Kevin Kerslake?
He's so fucking great. Had him on the show last month.
He's rad.
What a fucking great guy that is. Now, Here's my question. I always wanted to ask this question. When you sent the songs out to everyone, was it everybody got the same songs, those two that I got? Like, what made you guys pick those? Did you feel they were the strong representation of what the band was going to sound like?
I think we thought that they were.
Yeah.
There was a lot. I remember there was a lot of talk because, like, sometimes then we would get bored of the songs we were sending out.
Yeah.
We would just get bored of hearing the same vocal, different vocals on the same song.
Yeah, yeah.
And then sometimes we would think, like, with Fall to Pieces and Slither, we kind of knew that those songs had something special.
Yeah, you didn't want to give those out.
So we didn't want to send them out.
I got you, yeah.
So we kind of sent out, like, the closest that were kind of, you know, mediocre.
Yeah.
You know, but you could get a good vibe. So, yeah, I mean, we definitely thought about it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Look at those two smash hits I wrote.
There you go.
Did you actually hear when I auditioned?
I heard those songs.
Yeah.
I totally remember those.
Yeah, that's so crazy.
Yeah.
You know what that means? They're good songs.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I saw when I put it on for Dev, his gears were rolling like, oh, I remember this, you know? He was the one on my team. Now, how do you pick the name? I always wanted to know that.
I think that we had thrown around a bunch of names.
What were they? Do you remember? I was just curious.
No, I don't. Yeah. The only name I remember is that one of us had said Revolver, and we were going to call the band Revolver.
Right, after the Beatles record?
Yeah. I remember the day it happened, though. I remember going to a screening of The Hulk.
Yeah.
Because I remember it was like somewhere on the Paramount lot. Or no, it was up at Universal.
Yeah.
And I remember because all the special effects weren't done. So there was like some
That's so weird, right?
Yeah. And then I remember us walking out and then Scott said, what about Dead Velvet Revolver? And then we were like, well, it sounds a little too much like Stone Temple Pilots.
Yeah, yeah, three names.
So then he said, what about just Velvet Revolver? And we were like, I don't know. And then we just kind of sat on it for a couple weeks and then we're like, oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
But it was really like that.
I just remembered one of the songs I got was called Missile King. And I was thinking like, oh, that's probably the name of it, you know, like of the band. And they're not telling anybody. It was Missile King.
That was the only reason is because we had that board and we had so many songs. We would just think of.
Yeah, dumb names.
Whatever the name was of the. Because it sounded like Rocket Queen.
Oh, yeah.
Because there's a vibe in it. So we called it Missile King.
Oh, yeah. In the middle.
Yeah, the Passenger was because it sounded like
I Am the Passenger.
It reminded us of that Iggy song, Passenger. Rolling Thunder, I think it was just because of the vibe of the opening riff.
Yeah.
It sounds like a fucking freight train kind of.
Now, when you guys first play a gig, what was your first gig with as Velvet Revolver? I don't remember. Was it on TV or did you go do
No, it was, we did, I think it was at, it was either the Roxy or the El Rey.
Right.
I'm pretty sure it was the El Rey.
It was like just kind of a breakout. Here it is.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. We only played like 9 songs because we only had like 5 songs and then we played like 3 covers or something.
Oh, that's right. I remember. Yeah. I think you guys did a GNR song, like It's So Easy or something, right?
Oh, sure we did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, of course, we know what happens next. You guys sell a lot of records, and you go to do the second record, and the second record is a little bit weak. What happens there? Is it like, is it just scattered because Scott's starting to party?
No, I'm not saying
it's weak, but I'm just saying the first one had some hits on it, you know?
The second one was definitely weaker to me. I mean, I totally agree with you. You know, I think that it didn't have anything to do with Scott in particular. It was the fact that, you know, we had written like 40 songs for the second record.
Right.
And I just don't think that we were ready. It's weird because we started working with Rick Rubin on that record.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And whoa. Rick. What was Rick, that about? He was like, let's make a fucking classic rock record.
No, he was killer, man, but
how does he get involved, Rick?
Rick, because we just wanted him, you know, and we were like...
Such a god, right?
So we talked to him, he decided he would do the record, and it was a little weird, you know, like, he gives you these really super inspirational speeches.
Yeah.
they're not speeches, but you know, like these talks.
I played for him before, just me and him face to face at his house. Yeah. He'll be closing his eyes and he'll be like, I'm not hearing a chorus.
Yeah.
I'm not hearing, this is the chorus. And he'll just then come back later with some choruses, you know, like whatever.
That's exactly how it was.
Yeah.
So he would come to the rehearsal. He would lay down on the couch. He would look at his BlackBerry, lay it on his chest, close his eyes. And he just listened to everything we had recorded. And he just, you know, in hindsight, he was right. Because he said, I don't think you're ready. You know, like you need more, like try and expand on this or do that and do that. And we just got frustrated.
Yeah.
And then we got impatient, you know. And then I think it had something to do with like how much he charges bands. Like he has two different ways.
Yeah.
Well, he has two different ways of charging bands. One like newer bands and one for more established bands. We felt like we were a newer band and that we should get that rate.
Yeah.
But he wanted to charge us the higher
like
rate.
Like 5 points?
I don't remember what it was, but it was more money and more points. And I remember Scott and Matt were together and they both kind of flipped out and were like, oh, fuck that. We'll fucking, why that motherfucker, blah, blah. And then I remember Scott said, well, fuck that. I'll fucking call Brendan O'Brien right now.
Yeah.
And he called Brendan and Brendan was like, I'll do it for this much and we can start next week.
Wow.
And we were like, okay. And then we just jumped ship and fucking went with Brendan. But, you know, I think with Brendan, we just kind of rushed shit. You know, it was like, he started piecing songs together. It was like, well, that's a good verse and that's a good chorus. And, you know, and to me, it always felt like, and not even to blame him, but it just felt like we got impatient with Rick. We wanted to make a record. We made a record, but I don't think we were ready to really make that record.
Yeah, you made some expensive demos with Brendan O'Brien, and then you should have went back with Rick, like, right? Like, okay, we kind of, whenever you start piecing songs together, you're in some trouble.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can get lucky. Like when you guys gave me those songs, they were long 8-minute things or whatever. And you can hear things like, oh, this is definitely a verse. But if you don't really have something you can sit down on the couch and two guys play acoustic and sing it, it's probably not there yet. You know? Right. I always feel that. Yeah. You know?
I hear you.
So you do that record. And then when does the trouble start happening with the band? It starts to get crazy.
You know, it started right when we first got Scott in the band.
Right.
I mean, he got arrested like within the first 2 weeks of the band starting, I think.
That kind of helps though, right? Because you're like, you're getting some GNR style press.
He got arrested, I think.
Is that his birthday where he crashes into the cars?
Yeah, I think he was leaving the studio and he got arrested like right after he left the studio when he was finishing those three demos of Fall to Pieces and stuff.
So wow.
He got arrested at the studio where we would work at in Burbank. And then it just started like right off the bat.
Right.
He was on probation. We couldn't go on tour without hiring like an actual like police officer because that's the only way we could go out of state. So we had to pay for some guy to be on tour with us.
Wow.
And then
that's kind of weird, right? You got like
it was great because the guy was fucking great.
Like, really?
The guy, yeah. He's actually, I still talk to him. He's retired now, but he was like a really decorated Glendale detective.
Yeah.
He consults on Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Oh, wow.
Now he's
that's a Chelsea show. Yeah.
Yeah. He's the actual, the police consultant. For, you know, like, this is how you would hold a gun. This is what you would really do if you were going in a building.
So he's on the whole tour with you guys on the bus and stuff?
Yeah. He was on the first until they removed the probation.
Right.
But yeah, him. And then there was two other guys that worked under him that at one point where he couldn't do it anymore. We had another guy that was like a cyber crimes detective.
Yeah.
And then some other just like regular detective guy.
Now, when they're out there, are they on the bus? Because then you can't smoke weed or anything really, right? Like if guys smoked weed, let's say.
Yeah, no one was doing anything on the bus.
Right.
Except drinking if they were drinking. You know what I mean? Like no one was, I don't think anyone smoked weed ever.
Yeah, oh really?
They were all like, maybe, you know, once in a while, but it was all like drinking and
yeah.
pills or drugs or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
It wasn't. you know, so, and, you know, no one did anything else. Because we also had hotel rooms every night.
Yeah, yeah.
So we would just drive to the city and then everyone would get off the bus and go to their hotel rooms. They could do whatever they wanted.
At any point, was the cop turning into kind of like that psychiatrist on Metallica, Some Kind of Monster, where he feels all of a sudden he's one of the band guys? No. You guys ought to open with Falling to Pieces tonight. You know that?
That'd have been awesome.
Right? No. All of a sudden he's got chicks with him. Yeah. Hey, look at these girls. He's
hey, I wrote this riff. Yeah. I think it's pretty cool.
Yeah. Hey, I should have sang in the band.
He was an older guy with, you know, I think he's probably, he had no interest in being a musician. This guy was like a fucking lifer, you know, detective.
Yeah.
Like they made TV movie specials about this dude, you know, like I remember when I met him, I had seen a Channel 9, like late night, 3 a.m, you know, made for TV movie about one of his cases, and for some reason I remembered his name.
Yeah.
And then when I went to this dinner, our manager used to have these dinners where he would just invite like all these famous people, you know, and like, and then we would all sit down and like eat dinner together and like dinner parties, you know. And I was sitting across from John and I was like, dude, I saw this special, you're the guy that had the thing. And then, you know, then we were friends ever since.
That's fucking hilarious. It's so weird. It's so non-rock, right? Traveling with a cop.
Yeah. But it was, you know, it was fine. He's just like, he would just tell stories and just, he didn't care.
Yeah.
I mean, he cared, but he didn't. He knew, you know what? I mean, at the end of the day, he knew, like, if the guy's going to do drugs, he's going to do drugs.
Yeah,
he's going to sneak out of his hotel in a fucking, you know, with a mustache on and a wig.
Yeah.
So he can go get some drugs. He's going to do it. I can't watch the guy 24, like none of us could, you know. So it's like, if he's gonna do it, he's gonna do it. I'm just here to make sure he doesn't break any laws or break any you know requirements of his probation,
right.
And that was it, because I think he knew that he was kind of powerless over her.
It's a interesting thing. I don't know if you did drugs, but I did a lot of drugs, and I know Slash has done a lot of drugs, and Duff, of course. It's some people it grabs and it never lets go.
Yeah.
You know?
True. I mean, you know, I think it's a different, you know, from my experience, it's just like, it's a different thing. You know, it's like if you have the disease of alcoholism or drug addiction, then you know, you have it. And some people got it bad. And that guy had it, one of the worst cases I've seen firsthand.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like I said, I grew up here. You know, I know I did my share of drugs and drinking, and I was like, when I was working at Tower Video, I was bad. Like, I was really like...
What were you into?
Anything. But, I mean, mostly drinking. Like, I drank from the minute I woke up to the minute I passed out at night. Like, every day.
L.A., it was so... to me, Hollywood just felt like that. Especially the GNR era. I was growing up in that era. Yeah. It was, like, mandatory that you just got up and got loaded. I mean, you know, Night Train to me is just everybody's theme back then. And maybe it wasn't Night Train to me. It was Red Hook beer and vodka. But that was the thing, you know. Yeah.
Cisco and St. Ides.
That's it, yeah. St. Ides, you know.
Yeah, dude.
I remember there was a 40-ouncers I drank for a long time called Crazy Horse.
Yeah.
And then they had to change the name or something because the American Indians were pissed. But I drank the fuck out of that every day. And those were the soundtracks. Those songs are so real because that's how old the bands were.
Yeah.
You're living in shit warehouse or a bad studio apartment. You're drinking and you don't even care about eating.
Yeah.
You're just partying and rocking.
Yeah.
It's wild, you know? I mean, you know, so... It's been a couple of weeks and he's gone now.
Yeah.
Did you talk to him before, like recently?
Yeah. The last time I saw him was at my friend Donovan's wedding.
Oh, yeah.
We actually played, you know, like the Camp Freddy Royal Machines dudes.
Yeah. Yeah.
We played at Donovan's wedding. So Donovan's the singer, you know, one of the main singers. And we, you know, we did that same thing with, like, you know, it was me and Dave Navarro, Mark McGrath, Juliet Lewis, this guy Grant Fitzpatrick, who's playing in the Cult now. Just different people. Moby came up and did a song. I did a few songs. Sebastian Bach did a few songs.
Is that Donovan's wedding?
Yeah, it was down right down the street at Sunset Tower.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
That was like just a couple months ago. It was like 2 months ago or something. And Scott was there. We did a song with him, but you know, he was I had done probably a handful of shows with him this year.
Oh, really?
Yeah, with Royal Machines. I did a gig in San Diego. We did a gig at Petco Field. And he sang actually at my kid's school benefit 2 years in a row.
Wow. The one that Burr did recently.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that one.
Yeah.
We did it the 2 years previous. He sang both years.
Wow.
So, you know, I talked to him a good handful. And what's trippy is like my wife texted him like the day before he died.
Right.
You know, it was like, you need to get, because she saw these pictures of him on Instagram
yeah.
with the bass player and like riding a mechanical bull and holding up a bottle of Jack.
Yeah.
And she's just like, what the fuck is he doing? Like he needs to, what, you know?
Yeah.
Because like when sometimes when my wife and she would see Scott, you know, like my wife was on tour with us a lot. And,
oh yeah.
You know, because we had just gotten married. We got married when we were mixing the first record. So, you know, and everyone got along with her. So she would just go on tour and, you know, her and they had always gotten along really good.
Like a den mother.
Yeah. And I'd known Scott since Love Hawk days because we used to play with Mighty Joe Young
right.
before they were SCP. And so, you know, he would like say, you gotta get Velvet Revolver back together, you know, and she's like, all right, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
You know, and so it was funny because she sent him a text like, dude, you need to get sober. And, you know, that's the only way this thing's going to happen. And
then,
like 2 days later.
You think you guys would have got back together?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Honestly, I don't. Because I think there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of old, I think some old, like, you know, resentments and stuff that I think we're still there, that we're, you
battle
know, at that
wounds.
Point, we're still like keeping the band, you know, keeping certain people not wanting to play with those people. You
right.
know, it's like everyone sees each other and they're all cool with each other. But then when you think like, do I want to get back into a multi-million dollar business venture with this person again?
Right.
You know, and then you start to go like, nah, not really.
Now, did you start looking for other singers? I think the Stone Sour guy, right? So did he, after Scott's gone, check some singers?
Yeah, we checked a bunch, man. We did the same thing that we did before, but we just got a better quality of singers.
Yeah, because you had...
No, Dean.
No.
But, you know, we tried, like we worked with Royston Langdon, the singer from Space Hog.
Oh yeah, I remember that. That's right.
And then we worked with this dude, Ian Thornley from Big Wreck, which is this big Canadian band, which that guy's killer. Really talented. And we worked with Corey from Slipknot.
Yeah.
And then we found Frankie Perez, who was the guy that sang on that thing when Bill was playing.
Yeah, right.
At Wonderland. Who I'm still friends with to this day. And he was actually the only guy that had the gig for a minute.
Right.
You know, we hired him for a minute and then it ended up not working out, you know?
Yeah.
But he's so good. And he and I, you know, ended up being friends. And he moved here from Vegas because he thought he had the gig. And then he just... You know, we told him you don't have a gig, and then he decided to stay.
Right.
And coincidentally, he was like 5 blocks from my house.
Right.
And he would just come over every day, and we'd just write songs.
Yeah.
And so, you know, like one of those songs that we wrote back then, we sold to Meatloaf, put on his last record, and then he and I, and then we ended up when I did the Sons of Anarchy thing.
Did you write the title track?
I co-wrote it.
The Crow Frost Raid.
Yeah. I wrote you. I actually wrote the main riff because I had been talking to Shooter and I heard that country record and I thought, you know, I wanted to work with him because I had done some thing with him at the Hotel Cafe, acoustic thing with Shooter, because I was just a fan and I really loved that Wolf record. And I wrote that riff with him in mind.
Yeah.
And I wanted to do something with him. And when Bob, my friend who did all the music for the show, said, hey, you want to write something? And I said, yeah, I got this riff. And we wrote the whole song and, you know, that day. And I actually, Shooter was the first guy that I tried to get to sing on the song.
Right.
But because we had written the whole song already, vocals included and you know, everything, I think Shooter wasn't into it because he couldn't really put his own stamp on it.
Right.
He would just be singing it.
Yep.
So he actually turned it down. And it's funny because then his chick was on the show and, you know, it was just a weird coincidence.
Yeah, that is crazy, right?
Yeah.
That song became a fucking big hit, right? I mean, they sold it on iTunes or whatever, and it sold a shitload of copies.
Yeah, it's been downloaded like 300,000 times.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great song, man. Now, is that how you get into TV writing? Now, you're writing songs... Yeah. For Bill's new show, F is for Family.
Yeah.
Which is fucking hilarious.
It's killer.
It's on Netflix, people. It just came out. You can watch it. All six episodes right now. Wow, this fucking show is funny.
It's so good.
It is so good, man. Yeah. It's like, it's one of those shows I look at and go, man, how come I can't be that neighbor on the motorcycle? You know, I wanted to be Vic, man. Dude. I was like, oh, I'm Vic, man. I would have played it different. You know, been hey, Bill, you know, whatever his name is, Murphy.
Yeah.
Nuts to butts, you know, whatever. It's like hilarious, hilarious show. We were at the premiere a couple nights ago.
Yeah.
What music did you write for that?
Well, me and a guy, Vince Jones, who I used to share a studio with, we did all the music.
Yeah, all,
we did
of,
all
it.
Of it.
Wow, that's like, great.
Originally, I think they had some deal with the French, the Gaumont, the production company.
Right.
And they were going to bring in a composer on the French side. And because I had worked with the Wild West dudes, you know, Vince Vaughn's company, I had worked with them on another show previously. And I knew Peter, I've known Vince, you know, since Swingers and stuff. But they had asked me to do, if you've seen all six episodes, they came to me and said, we need a prog rock song.
Oh, yeah, I remember that one.
The Elfin King song.
Yeah.
And we need a Zeppelin sound alike song.
Oh, that's right. Kind of like remember... what was the Almost Famous? They had the song, it was total dunno, dunna. It was like Levy Breaks, but it was Steel, or I forget what it was called.
I don't remember.
That was total Zep too, about. Though, you know?
Yeah, so they had asked me about that song, those two songs, and I did them on my own, and then I guess they knew, like, you know, that I got what they were trying to do. So then later they... I guess they decided, you know, we want you and Vince to do all of the underscore. So we did all the music, like
that's
all the
awesome stuff,
you know, that when you hear in the background when they're watching the different TV shows, like Colt Luger.
Oh,
and
yeah,
all that stuff.
Yeah. Those you
we
doing
did
all that shit?
Stuff. Yeah.
Wow.
We did.
Now, how are you doing that? Are you looking at it on the screen and getting a vibe, or are you just coming up with shit?
No, we have to do it all to picture.
Yeah.
You know, it was like, because you got to follow the edits, because they had like specific notes, you know, they'll say like, okay, you know where he's here, it's got to change because he's more in peril. At first, he's fighting the biker gang, and then it's like, then the vibe has to change at...
Of course.
You know, and then you get time code, and it's like, at 3:34, it's got to change to... Because he's in peril, and then it's got to ramp up again at 3:54.
Yeah, strange songwriting, right?
Yeah. It's totally different, but it's... You know, I've been doing it now for, you know, four years or so.
Right.
So, I mean, like, now I kind of know what I'm doing, but...
You got to get me in there for some rock voices.
Yeah, dude. You never know. I mean, it's just like, it's weird. You know, you got to have a handful of dudes that can sing different ways
or
girls that can sing different ways, because you just never know what they're going to throw at you.
Yeah, I did some commercials for Diet Dr. Pepper. When I was there, they were like, hey, just do the rock one. I was like, okay. I was getting ready to leave. Hey, could you do country? Go, oh, yeah. I did the country one.
Yeah.
And then they go, wow, that was great. Hey, can you do reggae? And I've never done reggae, but I knew it was going to be way more money, like three commercials. So I was in there and they go, yeah, we'll skip on the reggae one, you know? Because reggae is really hard.
Man.
You know, it was like, man, you're just doing a lot of man, you know? But country is really easy to do.
And yeah, so we just actually got back from Jamaica. I went on a family trip.
Oh, yeah, Jamaica. I've been there. I went a couple years ago. It's kind of weird. Fun. Where'd you go? on a cruise, or did you actually go there?
No, we went to this resort in Ocho Rios.
Oh, right on.
Which is,
you got to go to a resort there because it is crazy outside. Gnarly. Yeah. I went on some Grateful Dead cruise. My buddy's band was playing. They're like, "We'll sneak you on as the tour manager." I'd never been on a cruise, so I was like, "It's free. Fuck it, I'm in to go." Yeah. And a bunch of my friends were there, and we stopped in Jamaica, and you're just kind of like, "Whoa."
Yeah, it's
you know, it's rad. Well, shit, man, I'm glad you did the show.
Yeah, dude, thanks for having
hell
me.
Hell yeah, and I know F is for Family's going to go again. I told Burr it's the talk of the town. Everybody loves it.
Yeah.
You know, it's a really edgy, radical cartoon.
It's a fucking funny show, and... You know, it's just so good. There's so many good things about it, like from the voices to even like for me, like as a parent,
yeah.
I got two young kids. So it's like, and what's even funnier is that like when we were doing the show, you know, you'd have to watch a scene like, you know, 20 times,
yep.
30 times. Cause the scene plays while you're doing the music, if you're starting, you
of course.
Know, fixing. So it's like, I found myself like there's this one part where he's drunk. You know, like after they go to the football game.
Yeah.
And he's
drunk. I love that one.
He's drunk in the bar.
Yeah.
And he's joking with the dude, Rosie. And he's like, "How's my goddaughter, Frankalina?"
Yeah.
Yeah. And my daughter's name's Frankie. So I would like call my daughter Frankalina and she'd like look at me weird. And, or, you know, because you're probably around the same age I am. And it's like you were raised more like they were raised in the. On the show.
It's exact to my life. You know what I mean? So drinking and driving.
Yeah.
Fucking shut up. You know, swearing.
Exactly. So if you have kids now, you're always on the fence between like the new school and the old school way of parenting.
Yeah.
And there's, you know, like, I got to explain stuff to them and just let them cry it out or just blah, blah, blah. And then there's a part of you that's just like, listen, you got to do it because I said so.
Yeah.
Why? Because I said so. Because I'm your dad. And, you know, and the more I watched the show, the more I started getting like that.
Yeah. You're just yelling.
Because what the, how come you guys?
Get in your fucking room.
It was funny, man. It was a funny experience to get like that.
Yeah.
And to have to like kind of reel myself back in.
To me, it seems a more realistic way of raising kids. I think that in the world of like, you know, I do a bit like there's no men anymore. You know, there's guys that don't know how to change a flat tire. You know, they use apps for everything and all that. And it's like, you know, when shit happens, they can't deal with it.
Yeah.
You know,
More Steve McQueens, dude.
Yeah, there's no more Steve McQueens and there's no more dads anymore either. An actual dad like the character of Murphy.
Yeah.
Who's like, you know, I relate with Murphy because it's a lot like you just once want to win.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like when I look at that Velvet Revolver rehearsal, I'm like, just once. You know what I mean? Like you do something all your life and you're like, come on. And him, you know, when you see the beginning, he's, you know, in college or whatever. And then he gets a draft notice and then he's just fucked.
It's all downhill.
Downhill from there. Lose your hair, get a belly.
Yeah, you got family.
You got a family.
Mortgage and fucking bills. And yeah, it's funny, man, but it's cool. It's a great show. And I love being a part of it and working on it and, you know, being able to like become friends with Bill and like hang out and like.
Oh, you made his dream come true. I mean, he played with Slash and Duff. I mean, he called me like I was supposed to go to that. But
I remember.
Yeah, I got ran over on the motorcycle.
Yeah.
He's like, hey, 3:00, meet me there. And I was really going to go. Yeah. I was like, and I was trying to get out of bed because I really wanted to go. I love Slash and Duff. Like I saw Duff a couple of nights ago and I'm like, hey, man. And then he's like, oh, he's up here. We talk and we have fun. But that band is so epic to me. And not in like a groupie way of like, oh, God, I'm not a fucking clown like that. I actually love what they did. They were my Zeppelin. They were my, you know, they were my Ramones. They were my whatever. Of course, I loved AC/DC, but that band, the way it hit, and they're all live, which is a miracle. So when I can see them play at any time, it's always like, I got to go, you know?
Yeah.
Which was cool that Velvet Revolver happened.
Yeah.
You know? What about Shooter? One more time, try it.
It's weird. We what happened? We actually asked him. I asked him twice. You know, I forget what the the first time he was, I honestly don't remember what happened. The first time he wasn't, I think he didn't want to do it.
Wow.
You know, and I think he was, I can't clearly remember, so I don't want to just start making shit up. Like, totally. Oh, I think he was this or, you know, but, and then I don't remember the second time. Once before Scott and once after Scott.
Seems like right now, if he did it, it'd be fucking killer.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Who knows, though, what's going to happen? Like, you know, obviously, you know, if you're a GNR fan, you hear tons of GNR reunion.
Yeah, That's happening.
Yeah.
There's just no way that's not happening.
Yeah.
I mean, we're not stupid.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You don't fire a band and then just not have something going on. I mean, that's the number one thing. He had a band and then they're gone.
Yeah. And if you live here, you know, you hear from every other person like, I heard they got, you know, this offer and they're doing.
It's all Coachella.
Yeah. They're doing Coachella. They got 25 dates booked or they got this and that. You know, but again, no one knows like what version or if it's.
Yeah.
No one can say for sure, but no one will say for sure.
That's going to be the interesting thing. It will happen, but it's like who's going to be on what drums version? And who's playing rhythm guitar.
Yeah.
You know? Which would spoil it if it's just not the dudes.
Yeah.
You know, I even think Adler can do it now. Those guys, if they can roll with Scott, they can definitely roll with Adler. And he's been clean over a year now. I think it's almost 2 years now because at the Bonzo Bash, it'd been 1 year and it was his 50th birthday, I think, that night. And so we'll see. And he plays, you know, he plays, but who knows? It'll be huge.
Yeah.
And were you a big fan of them?
I was a big fan, but not. I think it was, you know, like when I was at that time when I was, you know, going to clubs a lot and seeing those bands, it's like I was coming out of a more punk thing.
Right. So Jane's Addiction was more your.
Yeah. I mean, I listened to Appetite, you know, all the time.
Yeah.
But I would also listen to, you know, Jane's Addiction.
Yeah, me too.
You know, other.
I mean, nothing shocking is just as incredible as Appetite.
Yeah.
They're two crown jewels of Los Angeles, right up there with the, you know, the Doors and, you know, even X or any of these LA bands that are like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
This is like, it's the guys from here live here and make it. It's crazy, you know?
Yeah. I agree. So for me, it was, and plus I think because I knew Slash, you know, it was like kind of close to me. Like I didn't look at it the same way. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
I wasn't just kind of like able to not see it without like going, oh, that's a dude and blah, blah. And like, I remember the time though, you know. And so I looked at it. And because I think for me, because we went to high school together and I used to see he had this 3-piece band that would play all the time.
Yeah.
And for me, just personally as a guitar player, like I remember like how he used to shred back then.
Yeah.
And then he like kind of toned it down a little for.
Well, you knew it was that because he used to play BC Rich.
Yeah.
So there's no way you have a BC
Rich. And I was more into shredding.
Yeah.
So I was kind of, and honestly, there was a little bit of disappointment when I heard the GNR record, although the songs are like undeniable and great.
Right.
And, you know, but I was kind of like, ah, dude, like what?
Yeah. Just like you could totally Eddie Van Halen or whatever, you know? Yeah. Like,
I missed that because I was such a huge fan of his playing in high school.
Wow.
You know, and I would just see him like, he was just badass, you know? And I would just be like, fuck, dude, you know, like the world needs to hear that.
But yeah.
Apparently he.
Well, he was wise because they needed a new Aerosmith, and they were there.
He knew better than I do.
Yeah. One last thing. You got a mustache. I got one. Yeah. How long you had a mustache for? I'm just asking because I grew mine a couple years ago, and now I've had it. Now I'm like, yeah, maybe I'll get rid of it.
Now you shave it off, and you'll look weird.
I know, right?
It's fucked up.
Yeah.
I remember I've had mine since before the band. What happened was I had a goatee.
Yeah.
And then I saw... like, and I just only shaved my head like a couple years before the band.
Yeah. Were you going bald?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the tick. I don't understand.
It's
guys,
the comb over.
Why do people go comb over a horseshoe?
It's a fucking comb over the millennium, dude.
No chicks ever go, look at the guy with the horseshoe. I want to fuck him. Get rid of the horseshoe. And girls go, you know, I'm into bald guys. There's chicks out there like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's cold though, right?
It's cold. That's why we got these beanies
on. I know,
dude.
Right? It's like,
but you know, it, for me, it was like, I started seeing pictures of a lot of dudes, bald guys with goatees.
Goatee, yeah.
I think I was in a place where there was like one too many.
Yeah.
And all I did was shave out the middle of the goatee, and then it became this mustache. And I was like, oh, that's kind of cool.
Did your wife immediately go, what are you doing?
No, I think I might have had it when I first started going out with her.
Oh, man, that's a rare woman. You knew to marry her then, because if she's into a mustache.
I knew to marry her, dude, even more so, because she was fucking, we were going strong right before I got in Velvet Revolver.
Right.
When I had fucking nothing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And she was still like, I mean, you know, you knew. You like, you know, when you get married, you know, like, who is going to be your wife. But, you know, it was just cool, like, that we met. Right before that.
Yeah,
so
of course.
Never like
so there's no question of like, yeah. Oh, she just likes me because I play here. Yeah. I love that thought of like, I always think like, man, if I get rich in comedy, women are going to come at me. Yeah. And it's like, you got to worry about getting one spot first before you worry about the other,
exactly.
Right?
I mean, we were, but not only did we start going out right before I got in Velvet Revolver, but then even for the first 10 months I was in Velvet Revolver, there was no money.
Yeah.
Like, we didn't have any salary or money. Or I was working at the rehearsal studio where we practiced.
You were working at Mates?
I worked at Mates from 9 to 2, and then we rehearsed 2 to 6. I got a job there because I didn't want to lose my spot in VR.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't want to, like, because I would build sets, and I didn't want to just say, oh, I can't rehearse for 10 days because I'm on a job.
Oh.
And then just be like,
yeah.
Oh, well, Izzy decided to stay. And, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so yeah. I was so afraid of losing that.
You got
to
fucking go all in.
That I fucking worked at the rehearsal studio.
Real quick, what gear you play? I can't remember. You play Les Pauls?
I switch around. Right now in the studio, I have this... mostly Charvels and Les Paul.
Oh, wow. The reissue, kind of the old school Charvels?
I had a couple made that looked like old Strats.
Oh, I love the early. I had two of the old Charvels, man.
Yeah.
The San Dimas originals. Yeah, yeah. Those things are big money now.
Yeah.
I loved all those. The Bullseye one, the early Eddie Star ones.
Yeah, yeah.
I got the Charvel book. You got that? It's great. Oh, dude. Oh, it's got all the old Charvels in it.
I'd like to see that.
Who they were made for and shit.
That
cool. Stuff is epic. I love the new Eddie Van Halen guitars, like the Star one from Fair Warning's out now.
Yeah,
fuck,
yeah.
I love that one. And
that's
also
a Charvel, yeah.
Yeah, I love that guitar. And I love the black with yellow stripes.
Yeah.
I think everybody likes that Frankenstein or the white and black. To me, it's the black and yellow one.
Yeah.
And also the weird one that Dweezil has, that was the kind of triangle colors. He has that one. It's weird triangles that are colored. Yeah. And I love the new round circle Fair Warning Tour one too.
Yep.
All great. Man. Charvel's great. What a history in LA.
I love those guitars.
There's a time where a guy, Albert at Guitars Us, told me, you know, he has one of the biggest collection of 59s, slowly selling them or whatever.
Yeah.
But he said there was a time where guys would just come in with 59 flame tops and be like, you got a Charvel?
Yeah.
And he would just trade them out. And now he's got, you know, these guitars are worth $200,000 each, you know?
I remember Albert.
Yeah, Albert was great, right? And also, I really wanted to have Slash on for years because I love Les Pauls and I love that early shit. He had a Max, which was made around the corner from Guitar Center where G&R rehearsed. That guy Max made before Murphy made Les Pauls.
Do you know
Pauls.
Who has a couple of the Maxes? And a friend of mine who actually still talks to Max and actually still gets guitars is Stevie from Buck Cherry.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, the Asian guy.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Those guitars were because that was when Les Paul was terrible.
Yeah.
You know, they went from like great to horrible, you know, and heavy and dumb and changed everything to make them cheaper. And then Max was just making them exact pre-Tom Murphy stuff, you know. And he was right there, like next to Voltage, Lloyd.
Yeah.
Remember that fucking weirdo?
Yeah.
Lloyd with his two greyhounds.
Yeah. That's funny.
I love all those guitar stores in Hollywood. That was the shit back in the day.
Yeah, dude.
Well, thanks for doing it, man.
Yeah, man.
And what do you got coming up? Anything? You got a website? You got anything you want to pump?
I don't really have a... I mean, I just... I don't even have Facebook, dude. I have an old website, you know, DaveKushner.com, but I got to update it.
You got a Twitter.
But I got Twitter. What is it? Dave Kushner 66. And then I've got...
You born in 66?
Yeah.
Me too. So we're the same age. I'm going to be 50 here. I'm trying to put together a thing. You want to do it with me?
Yeah.
It's going to be me, Maron, and Burr, I hope, my 50th birthday at the El Rey.
We
do comedy, and then we do the Highway to Hell record.
Ooh.
Yeah. You want to do it?
Yeah. When is it?
Well, I'm got to lock it down here. February 3rd's the birthday, so.
Oh, snap.
You going to be around?
Yeah.
Here. You got to do it, right? We'll get like a bunch of guys.
Yeah.
And we'll crush it. Burr on drums.
Yeah.
Maron plays mean guitar.
Is he?
Oh, he's fucking great. And then I got all these other great players. Like we can have Tishy and we can have Joey C. And we can have, dudes from Queens.
Yeah.
Theodore, all kinds of shit.
That'd be fun.
I know, right?
Yeah, dude. I played with Brian too. I like
Brian. He played on my record. That guy's great.
Yeah. He took Matt's spot when Matt broke his hand.
Oh, he did?
VR, yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah. He played with us for, I think, like 8 shows or something.
That's a totally different feel, right? Yeah. Man, that guy can play. I love his playing.
Yeah. I love that. The Pride and Glory record.
Oh, are you kidding me?
Oh, dude,
Shine On.
I love that.
You know what? Like, I did a tour with those guys right before they did a deal. They were called Leonard Skinhead.
Yeah.
Before Pride and Glory, and I booked a tour. My band opened when we went out, and every night I watched them. Man, and it was just fucking crusher.
Yeah.
That record, Shine On, and. There's another song. Now you're just losing your mind. What a fucking record, right?
With the banjo thing?
Yeah. Sometime, babe, when we come out here. I love it because he was all Southern, you know? Yeah. But Shine On is amazing.
It was badass.
Great band, man. All right, dude. We could talk rock all day.
I got to get back to work.
All right. Thanks for coming by, man. See ya.
Thanks.